you know, if you look at RSA Conference 2020, we've really tried to focus in around this idea of the human element. And you've seen it everywhere. You've seen the posters. You've seen it as a theme in a lot of the talks.
With the human element.
The human element.
Investing in the human element.
The human element.
And it's one of the greatest unsolved mysteries, I would say, of the security space in a bunch of different ways. One is we need humanity. We need diversity of thought and views and perspectives to be able to deal with the security problem. That's one. And we've had a lot of sessions and workshops focused on that. We also need to understand that our users are very diverse and have certain ways of thinking, and we need to know how they're going to assess risk and look at a problem. But we also need to understand what our limitations are as people.
We need to collaborate not just within security teams, but with business, risk, IT, and users. Let's change our culture to a culture of perfection, to a culture of pragmatism. Don't let perfect be the enemy of the good.
What I want us to think about is, what do we not do that involves our phones? The addiction to mobile is what makes them so vulnerable. Think about this. If you get into my phone, you are getting so much more information than probably if you got into my Mac, because I live on my mobile device.
We look at the fact that when a user makes a mistake, it's the user that's the issue. The problem is not that users make mistakes, but that we put users in a position where they can initiate loss. They don't cause the loss, they initiate a chain of events, and that's a really critical issue to deal with.
It would be super convenient if you could just buy a piece of technology that would do everything for you. Unfortunately, security scanners and firewalls can't solve everything. Their effectiveness is directly related to the skills and the manual effort of the people who must tune them to a specific environment, monitor them regularly, and filter the signal from the noise.
What needs to happen is for every technologist inventing something really cool like differential privacy or quantum computing or whatever it is, we probably need something like 10 people whose role it is to explain it to the public and to policymakers, and more importantly, figure out how our public institutions need to change to best adapt to these technologies and minimize the harmful effects. You know, not lobbyists. We need neutral people to be doing that. That's something that I think we're lacking today, and something which I hope we can figure out in the next 20 years or so.
Humans will remain at the center of our story. In this world, the defenders will be better organized than the attackers, and the spirit of the defender will be strong.
So I guess it all comes down to the human element.
Hello, and welcome to day two of RSA Conference 2020 Asia Pacific and Japan. We're really glad you could join us today. There are three tracks of great content available to you, as well as interactive sessions, a capture the flag tournament, and great insights from our partners in our resource center. If you have any audio or video issues, please click the technical support button below. And it's now my absolute pleasure to introduce Anne Johnson, Corporate Vice President, Cybersecurity Solutions Group, Microsoft, for today's keynote.
Hello, everyone. First, let me begin by saying that I hope all of you, your family, and your friends are healthy and that you're safe. To say that we are living in unprecedented times is quite frankly an understatement. Each and every one of us has been impacted one way or another by the current events. We have had to adapt to new ways of life in our homes and in the workplace. and the pace of change has been at a rate that none of us have ever seen before. To put some perspective on this rapid pace of change, Satya Nadella, the CEO at Microsoft, summed it best when he said, "We have seen 2 years worth of digital transformation in just 2 months." Now, whilst the current health crisis we face together, and it has served as a forcing function to accelerate that digital transformation, we also must acknowledge that not all organizations were ready for this new world of remote work. They weren't ready financially, and they weren't ready organizationally. For example, in Copenhagen, the Emergency Medical Services Organization, which provides care to about one-third of Denmark's population, saw calls to its emergency lines almost double after the outbreak began, with around 2,000 calls coming in daily. The organization opened a second call center to handle these inquiries, but that wasn't quite enough. They began using artificial intelligence and natural language processing technology to help create their own bot, a bot in which the data is owned and solely accessible by the organization. But it allowed there to be a response to inquiries. It allowed a freeing up of doctors, of nurses, and other healthcare professionals so that those professionals could provide critical care to patients who need it. Given the global scale of the pandemic, technology will continue to play a critical role in nearly every facet of addressing COVID-19, from using artificial intelligence to crunch massive data sets to analyzing disease vectors and identifying treatment impacts. Whether it is meeting these unprecedented demands on healthcare systems or enabling the largest workforce in history to work remotely, we continue to see cybersecurity as the underpinning to protecting all of this data whilst helping organizations remain compliant and maintain business continuity as these same organizations adapt to this new world of work. But there's something really unprecedented. Cybersecurity has proven to be the foundation for digital empathy in a remote workforce. When billions of people form the largest remote workforce in history literally overnight, we learned much more than about how to scale a virtual private network. We were reminded that security technology is fundamentally about improving productivity and collaboration through inclusive end-user experiences. This is a huge paradigm shift for our industry, and I anticipate 5 longer-term cybersecurity paradigm shifts as a result. First, what we are experiencing in the cyber industry is giving rise to that term, digital empathy. Being empathetic to the end-user experience is something we must consider during times of constant disruption and constant change. So let's talk for a moment about what digital empathy means. We all know that empathy is our ability to put ourselves in someone else's shoes. But let's translate that to cybersecurity, because it's not quite intuitive. By providing security tools that are empathetic of someone's situation and forgiving of mistakes, people are protected and blockers to productivity are removed. This approach actually empowers people to work when, where, and how they need, and allows them to use the devices and apps that maximize their productivity. At Microsoft, when we implemented this approach, we saw a productivity increase as a result of our workers being able to use the devices and the tools that they need at the time they need them, where they need them, and how they need them. This is because digital empathy is also giving rise to a second paradigm shift, the zero trust philosophy. Zero trust is an assumed breach security posture, and it treats every step across the network and every access request for resources as a unique risk. Those risks need to be evaluated, and the user and the resource needs to be verified. Now, looking past the pandemic, we actually expect that zero trust architectures will become the industry standard. We saw zero trust shift from a business option to a business imperative in just the first 10 days of the pandemic. Companies who were relying on traditional security methods, things like legacy firewall solutions, they were much more susceptible to COVID-19 themed threats, and they were less able to dynamically meet the demands of a newly remote workforce. Building closely on the shift towards zero trust principles are also new ways of thinking about identities and new ways of thinking about authentication. Being a zero trust organization means the pervasive use of multi-factor authentication, which we know prevents 99% of credential theft. It also allows for other intelligent authentication methods that make accessing apps easier and more secure than traditional passwords. Looking past the pandemic, as workforces and budgets rebound, zero trust will become the biggest area of investment for cybersecurity. This means that right now, every single one of us is actually on a zero trust journey, whether we know it or not. The third shift the situation has made abundantly clear is that diversity of data matters. When we look back to early days of the pandemic, the power and the scale of the cloud and its advantage to combating threats was absolutely undeniable. Our cyber defenders were able to track more than 8 trillion daily signals from a diverse set of products, services, and feeds around the globe. A blend of automated tools and human-based insights helped to identify new COVID-19 themed threats before they reached our customers. These threats were caught and blocked, sometimes in a fraction of a second. This allowed our cyber defenders to quickly determine that adversaries weren't creating new threats. They were primarily adding new pandemic-themed lures to already familiar phishing attacks and already familiar malware. And as a result of the millions of targeted messages Microsoft caught every day, roughly 60,000 included COVID-19-related malicious attachments or malicious URLs. More enterprises are likely to embrace cloud-based protection and threat insights as a result of their experiences navigating COVID-19-related threats. These organizations will look for insights based on a greater, diverse data set that offers real-time protection to the breadth and depth of the organization's digital assets. Global events like COVID-19 also highlight the need for organizations to have a response plan that looks beyond security and beyond the scale. The fourth paradigm shift we see as a result, we see cyber resilience becoming fundamental and core to business operations. Cyber resilience is helping ensure business continuity. With more enterprises relying on cloud technology, developing a comprehensive cyber resilience strategy as a part of a holistic approach to operational resilience makes preparing for a wide range of contingencies less complicated. To maintain cyber resilience, one should be regularly evaluating their risk threshold and an organization's ability to operationally execute the processes through a combination of human efforts and technology products and services. Cloud technology will help organizations develop a comprehensive cyber resilience strategy as part of a holistic approach to operational resilience. And the cloud technology makes preparing for a wide range of contingencies less complicated due to its scalability. The fifth paradigm shift will be a greater focus on integrated security. When people often thought about security solutions in the past, they thought about a solution to deploy on top of their existing infrastructure and on top of their existing platforms. Events like COVID-19 showcase the need for truly integrated security for companies of all sizes. For example, the Commonwealth Bank of Australia quickly moved to a split tunnel model with Microsoft Security Solutions when they realized they had significant bandwidth constraints with all of their users going home and working from home. They needed secure direct access to web assets for their workers so they could be productive and they could continue with their business and maintain business continuity. We are seeing integrated security solutions as an absolute imperative. Attackers shifting from one technique to another is nothing new to us. But the COVID-19 outbreak has brought into stark reality how agile and how absolutely callous those attackers can be. Organizations will look to consolidate security tools for a more integrated view to help ensure that the next shift won't be into the organization's blind spot. And when facing a new economic reality, organizations will also be driven to reduce costs by adopting more of the security capabilities that are natively built into their cloud and productivity platforms of choice. This is one reason why digital empathy is so critical to how we move forward as an industry. Whether it is an organization or it is an individual, our ability to be empathetic helps us understand and to adapt to the needs of others during any time of disruption. Whilst the digital acceleration we are experiencing will continue to influence the paradigm shifts we are seeing, and these will shape our industry, one thing remains the same. Security technology is fundamentally about improving productivity and collaboration through inclusive, secure, and user experiences. Inclusivity is the key to so many things. Now, as much as I always wish I had a crystal ball and I could forecast a world post-COVID, I do remain optimistic and positive that as we work to connect and empower people through zero trust, through greater diversity of data, through cyber resilience, through integrated security solutions, and through digital empathy, all of these together will give rise to greater inclusive digital experiences for everyone. Thank you.